Sorry, Louise, I put you off your beat there. Good morning. It's good to see you all out this morning. It's good to come together just to worship God as we do so. I'm going to read a couple of wee passages just this morning. I'm going to read, first of all, from Zechariah chapter 9 and verse 9. And this is just, as we all know, this is Palm Sunday. And so Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9 says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. Righteous and having salvation is he, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." Then if you want to turn to Matthew, Matthew chapter 21, verse 9. Actually, verse 6 will start it. And that's this is the fulfillment then of this prophecy. So Matthew chapter 21, verse 6, and it says, "The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. And they brought the donkey and the colt and put on them their cloaks, and he sat on them. And most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went before him and that followed him were shouting, 'Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.' And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, saying, 'Who is this?' And the crowd said, 'This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee.'" We'll leave that reading there, but you can just imagine how amazing that would have been. As Jesus come through the city, as the crowds gathered and shouting Hosanna, praising name to our Savior. And that's what we're going to do this morning. As I invite the praise team up, they're going to lead us in our first hymn, "To God Be the Glory." And the chorus of this hymn, this well-known hymn, says, "Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, let the people rejoice." And it goes on to say, "We'll come to the Father through Jesus the Son and give him the glory, great things he has done." So let's stand to sing this wonderful hymn, "To God Be the Glory."
Yield in his life and
Thank you, praise team, for leading us in that. Thanks too to the tech team for all that you're doing, just giving us the words and making sure everything runs smoothly. So just thanks for all your hard work. So we've praised God. We'll now come to God just in prayer. We'll commit our morning to prayer. Let's pray. Praise the Lord. Let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice. Now we just come to you this morning and we rejoice in your name. We rejoice in you. We just give you thanks for your faithfulness, for your love, for all that you have given to us, Lord. We're just reminded of your creation as we drive through the roads, as we drive here this morning, in this lovely spring morning where we see the daffodils and the hedgerows, Lord. We see new life coming into the fields, into our gardens. We just feel the heat of the sun that wee bit more. Lord, we just thank you for your creation. We just thank you for the seasons. We thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for your design, for your creation, Lord. We thank you that you are a loving God who sent your Son, not just to die for us on the cross, but to rise again. We just thank you that the cross was not the end. The empty tomb, the risen Savior, Lord. And we come this morning to give you thanks for him. Lord, we just when we think about the new life coming into our fields, Lord, we just thank you for our farmers, Lord, and we pray for them at this busy time. We just know that the farmers in the middle are coming near the end of the lambing season, and that new season of work is just ahead. We're getting the ground prepared. But for all our farmers, for all the different activities that they do, Lord, we just pray for them this morning. I just pray that you give them the strength, you give them the energy, Lord, and all the pressures of the work that they're doing. And they're wrestling with the work, they're wrestling with the weather, they're wrestling with all the pressures that come their way, Lord. I just pray that you give them the wisdom to know to build in rest in all of that. That you give them rest, that you give them peace. We pray that for all of any of us that have our own businesses, are self-employed, Lord, and all the pressures that come with that. But again, we continue to look to you and for that strength and for that rest that's needed and for any employment, any of us that are in jobs, Lord, we thank you for that. But again, Lord, we are just mindful. We just ask you that we know that our jobs and our businesses and our employment are not the be-all and end-all. Lord, we pray that we don't allow those things to get above you. Lord, help us be mindful that nothing comes before you. Lord, help us to take that time just in your word every morning that we have that time of rest and replenishment, Lord. Lord, we just thank you too for our pastors, for Alan, for Luke. Lord, we thank you for them, but also we pray that they too have busy times and busy schedules. We ask you that you can continue to bless them, that you can continue to give them the words that you would have them to say, but also that you would give them that time of rest, that they know just to step back and to take things easy at the right time. Lord, we thank you for how you have strengthened them. We thank you how you have equipped them. We thank you for the faithful preaching week by week of your gospel message. And we just pray that continues as they continue to serve you. Lord, we pray for our world. I think especially this morning of the families of those young, innocent people who lost their lives in that concert in Russia. Lord, whenever we hear things like this on the news, we find it hard to understand. We find it hard to contemplate. Lord, we think of the innocent people caught up in the war between Israel and Gaza. We think of the war in Ukraine and other areas of the world, Lord. There's those innocent families, those innocent children that are caught up, who are bewildered, who cannot understand what is going on. And sometimes whenever we see that on the news, we cannot understand what's going on, but God, Lord, we continue to look to you. As we try to make sense of it all, we continue to look to you. We know that you are sovereign. We know that you are in control. We know that you are still God. We pray this time too for our royal family. We pray in particular for Catherine, Princess of Wales. And we realize this morning that she may be a member of the royal family and she may have all the privileges that comes with that, that she's also a young mother. She's a young mother of a young family. You're coming to terms with a terrible disease. Lord, we pray for healing for her. We pray for healing for others within our church family or within our friends and families who are battling with the same disease or with other illnesses. Lord, we pray for strength and understanding in these times for those people. And we pray for Catherine that she and that others may know you. Lord, may you speak to her at this time, that she may know true faith and have the real and steadfast hope in you. And through this darkness that you will shine through, that she will be convicted, that she will know you as her Savior. Lord, again, we just thank you that we can meet here this morning to praise and glorify your name. And again, when we do this, we just acknowledge your love for us and your faithfulness to us. And we just ask you that you continue to be with us as we worship and praise your name. We pray this in your precious name. Amen. I'll invite George up now to bring us our announcements.
Well, I'd like to give you all a very warm welcome to our service today if you're visiting, but you warmly welcome in the Lord's name, a special word of welcome to you. The announcements for the coming week are as follows. At the end of the first part of our service, again, we wait around the Lord's table to remember him in his own appointed way, and could I encourage you, please, if you know and love him, to stay and partake of the emblems at the end of the service. Fellowship night tonight at 6. So could I encourage you to come out? I know some of our folks are unwell at the present time, our numbers are down a wee bit. Could I encourage you to come out this evening at 6 o'clock for a time of fellowship together around God's Word. And then on Tuesday at 11, our seniors meeting once again. Seniors, remember that, Tuesday at 11. And on Wednesday of this week at 8, it'll be our church annual general meeting. So could I encourage all members, please, to make a special effort to come out and hear the different reports of what has happened during the past year. So that's AGM, Wednesday at 8. And then on Friday, Good Friday, it'll be a special service in the church. I think in the church hall we'll be meeting for a Good Friday service at 8. And we'll be meeting there again around the Lord's table on Friday evening. So please come out Good Friday. It's a special day in the life of the Christian church. And please come out and spend time together. Saturday, we're having our special Easter egg hunt that we've been having for the last few years. Make it known. There are flyers. These flyers are in the porch. So if you could take those with you, please, and make it known. And in the meantime, pray for good weather, because the ground will be a wee bit wet down there. So we need a drier day or two before it, and a really sunny, dry day next Saturday. So please remember that. That will be from 11 o'clock next Saturday. But please do take these and use them and make it known. Then next Sunday, service at 11, Easter Sunday. There will be no evening service next Sunday, so that gives you an excuse if you're having your friends and family along. There will be no evening service, but please do be with us next Sunday morning, Easter Sunday morning at 11. And then finally, just continue to remember Andy and Sylvia Lennox on the death of Andy's brother. Thank you.
Thank you, George. Okay, boys and girls, where are we all at? Yeah, we're all ready to sing your song now. We're going to sing, that's where we're at. Yeah, Sing Wherever I Go. Who knows this song? Sing Wherever I Go. Don't know why I'm... Oh, good girl, you know it. Do you know it well? Do you want to come and do a wee solo? No, you're thinking about it. Yeah, maybe not. That's all right. I wouldn't ask you to do that. Okay, so we're going to stand to sing our children's song, Sing Wherever I Go. I can see why that's your favourite. I tell you, I was going to sing that again, but I don't think my blood pressure could stick it. Very, very good. Boys and girls, before we pray for you and before you go to Sunday school, I just want to ask, who's on holiday now this week? Who's on holiday? Nobody? Just me? Oh, yeah, a few hands up. Good. We're all excited. Off for 2 weeks. 2 weeks, is it? I'm off for 2 weeks too. But don't be telling Pastor Alan because he'll just get jealous of you. I'm off for a whole 2 weeks from school. Can you imagine? I don't know what I'm going to do. Who's excited about the Easter egg hunt? I am totally excited. I'm going to gather so many Easter eggs. There's not going to be any left for the boys and girls. Because I'm allowed to do that. Aren't I allowed to gather Easter eggs, Leslie? No? I forget. Seriously? But I go to school. I'm not allowed. What do you think of that? That's shocking. Well, I'm not looking forward to Easter. No, I am. I'm looking forward to the Easter egg hunt. So we're all going, we're all practicing to gather Easter eggs, are we? Don't know how you can practice, but I know whenever our kids were small, and we used to send them to their bedroom to find their shoes for school or something, they couldn't find them. But yet they could always sniff out the sweets and all the rest of it. So I think boys and girls looking for Easter eggs will be really, really easy. So, just as we think about that, and as you go to Sunday school, I was just going to ask you, yes, why do we look for Easter eggs? Why do we have Easter eggs at Easter? Go on, Ellen. That is a brilliant answer. Yes, give her a round of applause. That is just perfect. I didn't think anybody would know that, but we have Easter eggs because it reminds us of the stone that was rolled away to show the empty tomb. Brilliant answer. So whenever you're looking for your Easter eggs next Saturday, whenever you're eating your Easter eggs over Easter, just remember that. That it's there to signify the empty tomb, that Jesus didn't die on the cross, but he rose again, and he's our living Savior this morning. So let's just come to the Lord in prayer. Need another wee hand before we close our eyes. What's the thing that I always forget to do? So I can't do this and spell at the same time. So if I do this, can all the boys and girls spell out pray? Can you do that for me, please? So, after three. 1, 2, 3. Lovely, thank you. Let's bow our head and close our eyes and pray. Lord, we indeed just thank you for that reminder of Easter time and of the Easter eggs that it actually signifies something really, really important. And as we take our Easter eggs, it reminds us of the empty tomb, of the stone that was rolled away. It reminds us of our risen Savior. It reminds us of you, Lord Jesus, our Savior who's alive today. We just thank you for that. It's such an amazing thing that you did for us, that you loved us so much that you came down to earth to die on a cross, but to rise again. And you did that all for us, Lord. And we just, at this time of the year, but every day of the year, we give you thanks for what you have done for us. We thank you for our young people. Thank you for the boys and girls and for our older boys and girls who come to this church, who go to Sunday school, who go to the Friday club, youth club, and youth fellowship. We just thank you for the blessing that they are. We thank you for our leaders as well. We just thank you that your gospel is preached and shared and the message is delivered week by week. And we just pray that as that's being delivered, as that message is being said, that your seed will fall in those little hearts and that they will come to know you as Lord and Savior. We just thank you for them. Thank you for our teachers and for our leaders. And pray that you continue to bless them. And we thank you for your word. And we pray for Alan now as he's just about to come up and to share your word with us. We just pray that you're with him, that you give him the words to say. Just pray that you're with Luke, Pastor Luke, as well as he preaches in Donnymanna. And just be all things to him that he needs. I pray too for Nigel as he speaks in Armagh. I just thank you for each of these men as they go faithfully to proclaim your name, to give you the honor and the glory. I just ask that you're with them and you're with our Sunday school teachers and you're with our boys and girls as they go into Sunday school now. We just pray this in your precious, precious name. Amen. All right, so we're going to sing our offering hymn before the boys and girls leave us, and we are going to sing His Mercy Is More. We will remain seated while the offering's been lifted, and then we'll stand to sing the final verses of His Mercy Is More.
Our sins. Turn with me, please, once again to 2 Timothy chapter 4. And we're turning to these verses. Really, we started last week. Really, we're in a bit of a series here as we really seek to conclude this book over these next number of weeks. And I've entitled these messages, Harmers and Helpers, or Helpers and Harmers. And really just looking at really different character studies different characters really that are mentioned here in this these verses, as Paul really seeks to conclude this letter and say just different people that he mentions, some good, some not so good, but I trust that we learn the different lessons from them. I did omit to say last week, before we started this, these concluding verses, verses 9 to 22, I'd finished off at verse 8. I can confirm that when I finished verse 8, I did get Sunday dinner that week, in case you were wondering, because it talked about longing for his appearing, talked about Heather just longing for my appearing, and I did get Sunday dinner that, so in case you were just panicking about it. But we continue on, say, really this morning. Good to see you here this morning. We are somewhat down a bit this morning if you're watching online, and we'd love you to be here. I know it's into holiday season, but if you're not away, we'd love you to continue to faithfully attend the services on a Sunday morning and Sunday night and Wednesday night. These services are vital for our own good, for our own benefit, and indeed we all need the fellowship as well. But the one thing caught me out this morning was Thomas' 2 weeks' holidays. I never got that memo, so I didn't write email. But we'll make sure we'll get him some work to do over the next 2 weeks. But 2 Timothy chapter 4, read from verse 9, really. Last week we looked at, we'll recap in a minute or two, really verses 9 and 10. Do thy diligence, Paul says to Timothy under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, do thy diligence to come shortly unto me. For Demas hath forsaken me, having loved this present world, and is departed unto Thessalonica, Crescens to Galatia, Titus unto Dalmatia. Only Luke is with me. Take Mark and bring him with thee, for he is profitable to me for the ministry. And Tychicus have I sent to Ephesus. We say we'll end there at verse 12 again, looking to the Lord to richly bless his word to all of our hearts this morning. Someone has said the church would be great if there were no people in it. Now, sometimes the person most often heard to say this, believe it or not, is a pastor. Pastors have been heard to say also, pastoring would be great if there were no people in the church. Now, sometimes this is said when church life is hard, because sometimes church life is hard. Sometimes there's trouble in church life, when sometimes as well there's sin and it makes life very difficult for the church. Sometimes within church life there is disappointment. But yet we know that deep down the church is in fact the people. The people of God, those who have been saved by the grace of God. If there's no people, well then there's no church. And really that's the bottom line to it all. It's people that make the church exist. But yet we know that when there's people, there's imperfections one way or another. And as I say, it's not an excuse for us to sin. We ought to have that great desire for holiness. If there's not that desire, we need to ask ourselves, are we saved or have we gotten away from the things of God? And we need to ask these serious questions. But we know that indeed when it comes to the church, no one will be perfect until we reach glory. But that means that then here on earth that there's going to be problems, there's going to be trials, there's going to be disappointments, there's going to be sin in the church, there's going to be, at times, there's going to be trouble within the church. And say, living with imperfections in the church, it isn't easy. Say, whether it be those of others or whether it be our own imperfections, because they say we all have imperfections, whether we like it or not. here on earth, there is no perfect church. As the saying goes, if you find one, don't join it, for it will no longer be perfect. And how true that is. There's no perfect church, and the same it was really back in the days of the New Testament. We talk about those days being glory days, great days. Yes, at times it was absolutely glorious in the church, but yet the Bible speaks about warts and all. It speaks about the imperfections of the church. And really what we ought to do is we ought to take heed to it all so that we can learn the lessons from it all. And that's why I've entitled these verses in 2 Timothy chapter 4, Helpers and Harmers. Because there were those that helped the Apostle Paul in the gospel and the taking forth of the gospel. But yet, as we will see in these verses, there were those that really were harmers to the gospel. And one we have already, because last week really we started into this. We looked first of all at the desire of Paul, and we saw that in verses 9 and 21, where really his desire was that Timothy would come and meet him. Remember, he is under house arrest. He's in Rome, and Timothy is down in Ephesus, and his desire was, as you see there in verse 9, he said to Timothy, do thy diligence to come shortly unto me. And in verse 21, he said, do thy diligence to come before winter. That was to use speed, as it were, to get quickly to see Paul, because Paul didn't know how much longer he would be alive. He was under house arrest. He could be killed. He could be put to death for his faith at any moment in time. And we saw indeed the great desire that Paul had to have Timothy with him for fellowship. And we considered that last week in terms of having fellowship with each other, encouraging each other, looking out for each other, but particularly those who are older in the faith, those who are older in years. We won't always have them here. We know none of us will always be here. But how much we benefit from them, and we enjoy fellowship with them, and we encourage them, and we look out for them and seek to help them. So we looked at the desire from Paul, or desire Paul, and then we looked secondly last week at the desertion of Paul. This was one of the harmers, as it were, because what we saw in verse 10, he said, Demas hath forsaken me, having loved this present world, and is departed unto Thessalonica. Sadly, we know in Philemon, verses 23 and 24, it's there that Paul talks about different people who were fellow laborers with him in the gospel. One man was this man, Demas. Now, we don't know what happened, that he ended up departing from Paul, far from God, because it says that he loved this present world. And that's a warning to us all. And again, I reiterate that warning today, because Satan is out seeking to devour us. He's seeking to draw us away. The thing about it is that so often it isn't something that just happens immediately, because Satan is subtle. And at times he'll do everything he can to draw us away from the things of God. And can I say that at times it saddens me when I see that happening, and yet we feel so helpless in trying to stop that. People that I see that are so committed to the things of God, but the reality is that at times you can see them, you can see while they're not running into the pubs and the clubs of the world, that yet they're getting more and more into the things of the world. They're getting further away from God. They maybe start to miss Wednesday night prayer meeting, or they start to miss Sunday night church, or they start then to miss Sunday morning church, and you start to see them less and less at the things in the life of the church. And I believe so often it's because Satan is getting them, or he's got them, and he's got their minds thinking on other things. We need to be so careful that we don't just drift so slowly and then find ourselves so far away from God and in the things of this world. So we see here, we've seen the desire of Paul, the desertion of Paul is verse 10. But then thirdly, as we move on this morning, I want you to notice with me what I've, hopefully you'll see this, the dispatched from Paul. Demas wasn't the only one really to have left Paul. Whenever he was under house arrest, say in Rome, as a number of others actually are mentioned here. But how we're to understand that that they left for different reasons. In fact, they left for the right reasons. Look here at verse 10. Well, he says, Demas has forsaken me, having loved this present world, departed unto Thessalonica. Then he says these words, Crescens to Galatia, Titus unto Dalmatia. And then if you look at verse 12, and he says, Antiochus have I sent to Ephesus. Now, not a lot is told us here, really, about Crescens, Titus, and Antiochus. And them departing to Galatia, Dalmatia, and Ephesus, respectively. Now, Tychicus, we see that he was sent by Paul to Ephesus. That is where Timothy was serving the Lord, so he definitely didn't leave under a cloud, like Demas did. As for Crescens and Titus, it's believed that they left Paul to serve the Lord in Galatia and Dalmatia, respectively. They maybe left Paul around the same time as Demas forsook Paul, but they left to serve the Lord elsewhere. And that was something we must notice this morning and believe it's important, because, you see, it's believed by scholars that there was no church in Dalmatia until Titus went there. Dalmatia is now the area we know as Serbia and Croatia and Bosnia and Herzegovina, and perhaps it was similar for Crescens going to Galatia. Perhaps there were no churches in those places until they were sent there by Paul. And here's the big lesson, I believe, this morning in thinking about this, is that even though the end of life was near for Paul, what is it we see was his concern? His concern was that the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ would continue to advance into other places. That's why he sent these people. He was sending Tychicus down to, as we see in verse 12, down to Ephesus. What was it he has just mentioned? He is wanting Timothy to come from Ephesus. So Paul was really making sure that Ephesus was not going to be left without a spiritual leader, that Tychicus was going to be there. And whenever Timothy would leave there and head to Rome, that they, the people there in Ephesus, would have somebody to continue on with the church there and leading the church, taking it forward in the gospel. But Paul's concern as well was for Galatia and Dalmatia, because he wanted these two other men, Crescens and Titus, to go there. And to say it's believed there were no churches there before that. And I think this is a lovely picture of the Apostle Paul and the heart that he had for the gospel. That here he was coming to the end of life. He may never have set foot outside the prison again, but yet he wasn't just, and we've looked at how he said at the end of his life, we've looked at it in verses, particularly verse 7, where he said, I've fought a good fight, I've finished my course, I have kept the faith. Does that mean then that really that was him finished with concern for it all? Absolutely not. That here was a man who still had great concern for the advancement of the gospel, for the going forth of the gospel into so, so many other places. We see that he was covering tracks already laid, but new tracks were soon to be laid by all accounts. And how important, remember this, whenever, if you find yourself today, that maybe you're nearing the end of life or you're no longer able to be involved as you once were, that indeed that you may be somebody who can, you still have a vital part in it all, because the heart of, your heart really is that you want the gospel to continue to go forward and that you're encouraging others to continue to go forward with that work. Because that's what we see here with Paul. Paul was, say, at the end of life. He was never going to, say, set foot outside that prison cell again. But yet, what is it he's doing? And I believe it's a continuation on, really, of the work that he'd been doing through his life, of seeking to raise up others to go forth and to take the gospel into other places. And that's a vital work that any local church ought to be involved in, and seeking to, say, to raise up people to go and to take forth the gospel. Because because there's still such a great need out there in today's world, and we need to remember, and as I believe Paul here, Paul was absolutely of no doubt that the work was not his work. It was God's work. It was Christ's church, and Paul wanted to do what he could so that others would be taken forth the gospel. How important it is that as a local church that we seek to be raising up others. It's one reason we've brought Luke on board. It's the reason we've brought Thomas here. But it not ought to be just people coming from other churches coming here so that we can help and train them and then, God willing, in the future see them go forth into other places and spreading forth the gospel. But here within our own church. That there are people here that we're seeking to identify, and we long to see you not only involved in the work here, but that maybe someday the point will come where God will make it clear for you then to go somewhere else. You see, what's happening is that, and I've been at the pastor's conference recently, and we're reminded about it every year whenever we go to the pastor's conference. And Baptist missions are there as well, that every year that I've been at it, what we have noticed is that there's always one or two less pastors because they've either retired or they've been taken home to glory. And likewise with ones in Baptist missions, maybe some that say have retired or they've gone home to glory or they've moved on into other ministry. And what is needed? Well, what is needed is others to come through at the other end so that the gospel is able to go forth. And really, I just asked the question this morning as we think of it here in this local church, who's up for the continuation of the Lord's work? Who is that the heart and the desire to study God's word and to be involved in the work and to give of ourselves to be able to do what we can so that the gospel can continue to go into other parts of this world? I was sharing it with the young people Friday fortnight ago, I think it was. Luke had asked me if I would speak to the young people at BYF about the Great Commission. The Great Commission, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And I was sharing with them about the importance and about the size that there is of the mission field in today's world. It's estimated there's still 42-43% of this world who are still waiting to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ for the very first time. Yet here we can hear it every day. Yeah, at times, perhaps we don't listen to it and we don't study it as we ought to. We're so privileged, maybe we just take it for granted. But yet, there's other parts of the world today they don't even have a page of scripture, and they're crying out for people. Or I believe there are parts where maybe there's a few have heard it and they've responded to the gospel call. Do you know what often is the cry of those people? The people from here would go there and take forth the gospel to them and help them in the development and the progress and in the growth of the Church of Jesus Christ. Like the Macedonian call, as Paul heard, come over and help us. I believe that's the cry of many people in other parts of the world, and say there's parts where there's not even that call. Why? Because they don't even know about the gospel. Paul, what we see, was a man, and well, he was a missionary first and foremost in terms of the churches he planted. But even when he was getting to the end of his ministry, what is it his heart was? That it was sending out others. Is there somebody here today that in fact that you're going to be the answer to it all? That you're going to be the answer to the call? That you're going to say, here am I, Lord, send me. I was just thinking about this morning that, forgive me if I'm wrong, but I think, well, I know that here in 2 months, God willing, I'll be here 6 years. One of the things I've prayed for, but I've never seen an answer to that prayer, is that people here will say, here am I, Lord, send me. We as a church are getting behind people to go into other parts of the world and to take forth the gospel and and indeed to spread the good news. It doesn't just have to be our young people. Because God needs so many gifts on the mission field. He needs so many people who are involved in so many different ways in the mission field. It's not always about going to be a preacher and somebody to go and teach the gospel in depth. Sometimes it's, and we think of people like the Martins who have gone to Indonesia from Korean Baptist. We've had them here in the church. What is it they're doing? They're making chocolate. And yet through that, they're seeking to reach others with the good news of the gospel. There in Indonesia, they can't have a Bible study. They can't have a church. The authorities would throw them out of the country immediately. Maybe there's a practical gift that you have. Maybe you could take and you could go to another country and there you could use that just so that you can get alongside people and reach people with the good news of the gospel. What is it Jesus said? He said, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white unto harvest. And then what is it he said also? He said, pray ye therefore that the Lord, he would send laborers into the harvest. Do we pray for that? Have we ever thought that maybe actually we could be the answer? The answer to that prayer. That God is calling us to go and to labor in some other part of the world and to take forth the gospel of Jesus Christ. So we see here the dispatch from Paul. Those who were sent out. Paul, at the end of life, he wasn't saying, well, this is the end, that's me finished now, and we'll just forget about it all. No, he was making sure the work was going to continue on. But not only do we see then this morning the dispatch from Paul, I want you to note secondly with me the delight of Paul. And what a blessing this is. And I believe this will be an encouragement to many of us, if not to all of us this morning. Look here at verse 11 as then the focus turns from the three men that he has mentioned, from Crescens and from Titus and from Tychicus, because then he talks about Mark. Look at verse 11. Well, Luke is with him. That's Dr. Luke. He's the only one there with him. But then he says, take Mark. And bring him with thee, for he is profitable to me for the ministry. Now you may be saying, well, why is this an encouragement to us here this morning? Well, what we need to remember is the history to it all. The past as to what had happened. Remember Paul and Barnabas, they were sent out by the church in Antioch in Acts chapter 13. And they were sent out really as what is known as the first New Testament missionaries. And there they went to many different places and they proclaimed the gospel. They had the joy of seeing people getting saved. They had the joy of seeing new churches planted. But then we know that after a year or so that they come back to the church in Antioch. And there they come back and they reported of all that God had done on their missionary journey, and there was great rejoicing in it all. But then there came a day when Paul decided that, right, now's the time to go back and visit these churches, to visit these new believers, to see how they're doing, to see how things are going. And no doubt he had the heart as well to go and to spread the gospel into other new places, which is in fact is what he did on the second missionary journey. And everything was great until Paul suggested something that Barnabas didn't like. Because what he suggested was that he would take John Mark with them. But what we need to remember, and you can read about it in the book of Acts, is that on the very first missionary journey, John Mark, he was with them. But then there came a day when really, what did John Mark do? He abandoned ship and he left them. And Paul was not a happy man. We don't know why he left them, but certainly Paul seemed to appreciate and value John Mark's ministry. It says in Acts 13 and verse 13, now when Paul and his company loosed from Paphos, they came to Perga and Pamphylia, and John, departing from them, returned to Jerusalem. And say, we don't know why that happened, but Paul had appreciated, it seems by all accounts, John Mark's ministry, but then this had happened, and Paul wasn't a bit happy. So then whenever it came to the second missionary journey, Paul suggested, they go on a missionary journey, but wasn't Paul, it was Barnabas, suggested they take John Mark, but Paul wasn't having it. Then what is it we read here? This is years later. What is it he said to Timothy? He says, take Mark and bring him with thee. Then notice these words, for he is profitable to me for the ministry. That's nearly the last words you would expect to come from Paul regarding John Mark. John Mark had really let them down. And here we are yet, we're years later. And what is it Paul is wanting? Paul is wanting Timothy to get John Mark and to bring him up to Rome with him. Why? Because he said he's profitable for the ministry. Now, what we understand is that in between things had been sorted out. What we understand is that their friendship had been reconciled. What we understand is that John Mark, in fact, was somebody who'd go back into the work again. And he was being used by God once again. I believe that as we look at this morning, there's two obvious lessons. I don't know if I've done it in big enough text for you all to read it there this morning. But the first lesson is this. As we think of the delight of Paul and calling for John Mark, the first lesson is this: don't let yourself be written off for good when you've let God and others down previously. I think that's an important lesson for us all to learn. Don't let yourself be written off for good when you have let God and others down previously. How the devil thrives on this. How the devil loves to hinder the people of God from serving God as they get older by doing what? By focusing on their past failures. But not John Mark, as we see here. And I say we don't know exactly as to how and when he got back at it. But here's the thing. Back at it, he got. And there came a day when Paul was able to say to Timothy, bring him to me, because he's profitable to me for the ministry. And what we also know about Mark is that, in fact, not only did Paul trust him, but God totally trusted him. Because what is one of the things that he did in his life after he had failed, or he had left Paul and Barnabas on their first missionary journey? What we see is that God actually entrusted him to write what? The Gospel of Mark. In light of this today, are you somebody who is not fulfilling your potential for God because of a past failure, disappointment in your life? I want to say that an amazing and comforting truth of Scripture is that God uses failures. It was John Maxwell who does leadership seminars. I think he said, well, God, of course, will use failures because there's nobody else. We all have failed God, have we not? But yet when you look at Scripture, we think of how Peter used mightily by God. What has it happened with him? He denied the Lord. We will probably hear about that, or you'll read about it maybe throughout this next week as we approach Good Friday and as we approach Easter Sunday, but particularly Good Friday, how we know that Peter denied the Lord three times and wept. Yet, not that long afterwards, he preached. The Lord had dealt with him. The Lord had brought him back, restored him, and he preached. About 3,000 were added to the church on that very first day that he preached. Think of Jonah. We were hearing about them in BB night. The junior boys were doing a sketch on Jonah, and God called him to go to Nineveh, but what is it he did? He jumped on a ship, and he went the opposite way. And yet whenever he came back and he went to Nineveh after that failure, one of the greatest revivals that ever happened in the Old Testament times, if not the greatest revival, happened because Nineveh repented as a city. Think of David. He committed adultery. Noah got drunk. Say so many that you could go through in the Word of God. And they were all people who had that mark in their life. And here we are several thousand years later, and we're still going back and talking about their failure in their life. But yet, whenever you read on in Scripture, what is it we read? We read of how they were taken and they were used by God in a mighty way. Is it today that you're somebody that you're feeling, oh, I'm the absolute failure? You see what God can still do in your life? You come, you confess it. And He can still take you up and use you in a way that you would never have expected. The devil wants us to live in the past, but God wants us to press on into the future so that we can serve Him and let Him flow through us. The world, yes, they might, and other, even sadly, other Christians might remind us of our failure, of our sin. But oh, if we're given to God, we can be taken and be used mightily. To say the delight of Paul concerning John Mark, say, first of all, don't let yourself be written off for good. When you've let God and others down previously, and then secondly, don't write others off for good if they have let you down on a previous occasion. I think that's so important. Say, don't write others off for good if they have let you down on a previous occasion. Now, if they keep doing it more than once, you give them that second chance, that third, fourth, fifth chance. Yes, you maybe have to come to a point where you decide, well, enough is enough. But if God is the God of the second chance, I believe that so ought we to be. How many people, I wonder, in the church have wanted a second opportunity, but someone stood in their way, not giving them another opportunity? The potential has never been realized because somebody wasn't forgiving. Perhaps it's not a pastor or department leader who's digging their heels in on this today, not giving somebody else a second chance. We expand it out. Perhaps it's a parent who won't give a child a second chance. Perhaps it's because of favoritism. Other children are getting more than a second chance, but as a parent, there's something in you not letting one of your children have the same chances to try again for whatever reason. And sometimes that can happen within family life, even within a Christian home. This is a true story. We might laugh at it, but I think there's an important lesson. Police stopped a teenage girl in her car on one occasion after complaints that a car had been seen going around her neighborhood in reverse for some time. The girl says she was stopped by the police, asked what she was doing. She told the police that her parents had let her use the car, but she had put too much mileage on it. Here's what she said. She says, I was just trying to unwind some of it. And we all laugh because, well, we know that that's not possible. But there are times we can't unwind it. Yet I believe we ought to say sorry. And if somebody apologizes, I believe we ought to give them a second chance, even as a parent. Or perhaps today it's as an employer. Maybe there's somebody in your factory floor or working in your place and you're not giving them a second chance because they've done something that let you down. Maybe you didn't sack them and you're saying, well, that's surely enough, but yet you're not giving them the chance to go on to greater things. You're standing always in their way. Or maybe it's even as a teacher. There's one pupil you're not giving the same opportunities to because they misbehaved or they did something to you that maybe humiliated you, embarrassed you as a teacher. But what we see is that God is the God of the second chance. Woodrow Crowell, he said this, he says quite honestly, most people are quick to write someone off, but our God is a God of the second chance. Learn from one who is patient with you, and you'll learn to be patient with others. Is there somebody today that maybe we're the one that's standing in their way for progress? Progress as a Christian, and development as a Christian, development as serving God. Oh, today, what we see is a lovely picture of Paul's heart of forgiveness. Because if he hadn't had a heart of forgiveness, he knows where John Mark would have ended up. But there'd obviously been something that had happened. And John Mark today, say we thank God for him. Why? Because not only was he profitable to Paul in the ministry, but he's profitable to all of us in our Christian lives. Why? Because he wrote a letter that did what? Presented Christ and his so great salvation, and presented the Savior of the world. And it's a message that has been used even to this very day. Oh, today may we learn from Paul. May we learn from these people that he wrote about. And indeed, we take the lessons into our own lives and let them be applied to our own lives day by day. Time is gone. We'll leave it there. We'll come back again, God willing, in 2 weeks' time or 3 weeks. Next week, of course, is Easter Sunday, and we'll be focusing on the resurrection message, and God willing, Luke will be preaching next Sunday morning. We're going to conclude by singing our hymn here. There is good news for the captive, good news for the shame. There's good news for the one who walked away. There's good news for the doubter, the one religion failed, for the Lord, good Lord has come to seek and save. Maybe today you're not saved, because maybe you're saying, well, actually, I'm not saved because there's one particular failure in my life. I just don't know if he could forgive it. Well, here's the great news. The Lord Jesus Christ cleanses from all sin, even your very sin that you think is too much for him to cleanse you from. He is able to save you, able to deliver you. He's our rescuer. And indeed, he's the rescuer of those of us as well who have failed the Lord and maybe feel today, well, we're no good to him anymore. Oh, today may all of our lives be given completely to him. Thank you. prayer of our hearts this morning is that the outcome of your word to our hearts today, that we feel our Father delivered from bondage. Perhaps today someone's still in their sin, and our Father, they have never experienced deliverance. We pray today, Lord, that they will put their trust in the Lord Jesus Christ and be set free by him. But Lord, perhaps today they're Christians. Maybe because of some sin in their life, they feel, our Father, in spiritual bondage. They know that they're saved, but Lord, perhaps today they feel they no longer can be of any good to you. They no longer can be used by you. Lord, we today pray that in confessing their sin afresh, they will experience, Lord God, being set free, and that, Lord, that their lives can go forward. No longer are they living in the past, but they're living, Lord, looking forward to the future and service for you. So, Father, bless your word to all of our hearts. And again, for those who must leave us now, your good hand to be upon them. And for those of us who remain here at the Lord's table, may we come with thankfulness, rejoicing in our so great salvation. And we pray it all in Jesus' name.